Kind of lean into it.
Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to church. And I'll just say this for the sake of everybody. It's good to be back. And it's great to be back with each and every one of you. We had two Sundays off, one full week. And we had a blast with our wedding of our son. And I forgot my clicker, so we'll change all that up in just a second. But we want to welcome each and every one of you here live. Those of you on Facebook, good morning. We've missed you for a couple Sundays, but we're back. And we are glad to be back. We're going to be celebrating and worshiping our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And we're going to begin in just a minute, so talk amongst yourselves, get your fresh cup of coffee. And so we want to talk about what's new at a Heritage Bible Church. And we've got a couple announcements. I'm going to move away so the camera can see that. First of all, we want to celebrate all the birthdays. Carol Wagner, you've had a birthday here. Marilyn Theobald. Donna Rust, she's with us today, so is Carol. And Thelma, right over here. You got a birthday, right?
Yep.
Coming up towards the end of the month. You'll be 26. Amazing. Where does the time go? We remember when you were this high. Thelma, we're glad to have you here. A couple more announcements coming our way. Don't forget, we changed our honoring service of those who have passed away, our Saints Day. Normally, it's the first Sunday in November. Actually, the official date is November 1st. And I remember that because that's my uncle's birthday, who's with the Lord today. And but the 27th will be that day where we will be honoring those who have passed in the past year. And so if you are new to the church or you're just here attending maybe occasionally and you have a loved one that has passed, would you share that with me? My email's in the bulletin, or you can message me on Facebook. And let me know, and we'll get that name up there on the screen as we honor them. Another announcement coming up. Don't forget the church picnic. Now, hear me clearly. Write this down. We need a head count of you and your friends coming because we need a head count for the gurus over there. And we want to make sure we have an accurate account. This is an all-church picnic. It will be in the Snoring Grill, right? Is that right? Sonoran Grill, following the service, roughly 12-ish, I think.
11:30.
So being 11:30 in the Sonoran Grill, everyone's invited and your friends. But, and here's the big but, we need a head count. So again, put an email towards myself or Carol. Carol's email's in the bulletin. Don't walk up to us and say, hey, I've got myself and five people coming, because it's Sunday morning and that information goes whoosh, 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 out. Okay? I need it in writing. We need it in writing. And put your name, and if you have at least a name of a friend, we'd like to know that too. And if you don't need, if you don't have a friend, man, let me know. I've got a couple I can spare. So, be glad to have that. And then, oh, how did that get in there?
Oh, how cute is that?
This is the girls and the wedding party. That's the bride in the middle. Her name is Alyssa. And our two daughters were in it. That's our one daughter here. She's our youngest, and she's our second oldest. And this is Alyssa's sister. And don't ask me who these are because I forgot. I met them, and I lost their names already. And here's the boys. And this is the proud groom right here. It's our son, Jonathan. And can I just tell you a little bit on the backstory? There are There are one, no, no, one, there was two others. Two, yeah, one, two, and there was a third Marine who came from clear across country to be at our son and daughter-in-law's wedding. And they told us stories about our son that we are still treasuring in our hearts of what our son meant to that group of men when they were all together and how he brought them all together because they were divided. And so it warmed our heart. And the other two or three guys are from high school that they've known each other since fourth grade. This guy here, here, and here, they've known each other since fourth grade. And they came to the wedding. So that a big theme was relationships, if you can't tell, this weekend. And we earned another family, and they have another family in us. We'll see if they still like us. But that's them. And this is the venue. Outside as you walk in, it was an old abandoned barn someone invested in, and it's called Nourish Farms. And then that's the inside where the reception was. It was up on the second floor. It was beautiful. And here's the happy couple. So Mr. and Mrs. Alyssa and Jonathan Paul Fredericks. So that's them right there. And we are so thrilled. So thank you for allowing us to have some time off to be able to do this. We're grateful to be back. And we want to begin our call to worship, starting with a great psalm, Psalm 16:11, which tells us, "You will make known to me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. In your right hand there are pleasures forevermore." Let that sink in. In his presence is fullness of joy. There's no other joy. You can't get any more joy than being in the presence of the Lord. And that's what we want to do today. We want to come into the presence of the Lord and let him be our focus today. Let's begin as we start the doxology. Just adjusting the music here because these two songs are drastically recorded on different levels and I want to blow your eardrums out, so please be patient with me. Thank you. It's
yeah.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
This Sunday's reading is from 2 Philippians verses 5 through 11. You must have the same attitude that Jesus Christ had. Though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges. He took his humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on a cross. Therefore, God elevated him to the place of highest honor and gave him the name above all other names, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue declare that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. May God bless the reading of his word.
As we approach the throne of grace this morning, you ever want to pray for someone and you're just really not sure what to pray for because you're not aware of any needs or any concerns or even something to thank God for other than thank God for my friend? There's a passage in Scripture where Paul says, I make mention of you before the Lord. And sometimes just going, Lord, I don't know what's going on, but we make mention of Mary or Joe or Tom or whoever it might be. So I want you to look to your left and then look to your right. Okay, go ahead and do that now. Look to your left and then look to your right. And if you don't know a name, ask them their name. And I'm going to give you a moment to make mention of their names this morning before the throne of grace. You don't have to do it out loud. Just say in your mind, Lord, I'm mentioning Ann to you today. I'm mentioning Jim and Raquel to you today. I don't know what's going on, but you do. And that's a good thing. Because sometimes I don't need to know. But the Lord does. So will you take a moment, I'll give you that moment, and pray for the person on your left and then on your right. You tell us that in your presence is fullness of joy. We're thankful for the fact that you humbled yourself by becoming obedient even to death, death on the cross. And you've come to tell us that we need to have this same attitude of humility to do whatever we're called to do by the Father. To take on the form of a servant And not only serve, but serve to the point of personal sacrifice. Something our culture has no concept of. And in fact, at times our culture views it with contempt. But that's what you've called us to. So this morning, Lord, I pray for our hearts to be ready to hear your word. Prepare our minds, let our hearts hear what you have to say. May the word of God plant seeds to reap a harvest of 100-fold. And Lord, that Christ would be glorified ultimately. Thank you for this church and for those on my left and my right and those who are in front of me. I make mention of each and every one of them to you, Lord. In the name of Jesus, I pray that they would hear your voice and experience you and the fellowship of the Spirit in ways that they have never experienced you before. That we would go deep, and that we would be deep and rich people following you, Lord. That's what we pray for. That we would be fully committed followers of you, King Jesus. You are Lord. And we obey the King. No matter who's in the White House, no matter who's in the governor's mansion, no matter what happens after November 5th, you are King. And so today, remind us of that and give us ears to hear and hearts to obey with passion. As we pray together, united, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day bread and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen and amen. We're going to sing a song that has been since the Reformation, when Martin Luther penned this song, "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God." Now more than ever, today and every day, we need to know that there is a fortress, that the Lord is our refuge. Psalm 27:1 says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Whom shall I dread?" He is our refuge, beloved. We can trust him. No matter how dark the road gets or our way becomes, no matter how fearful that our enemies may appear to be, God is our light who will guide our path and our refuge, a place that we are safe. Let's sing together.
Thank you.
Well, good morning again. I understand there was a little bit of a concern on the first Sunday about a certain topic. I'll be here after service for about 5 minutes, maybe 10, to explain a little bit about the first and second Adam. And so if that was a point of concern for you, I'd love to talk to you afterwards. And if it doesn't concern you, then that's okay. You can go to lunch. So glad to have that. So it'll be right afterwards. We'll meet right over here somewhere, and we'll have a quick chat on that. Much like our culture, the culture of the first century with our Lord Jesus was very similar. Let me give an example. In our culture today, there's a lot of anti-Semitism, isn't there? And it's rising everywhere, including on our campuses and in the city streets. Well, back in the first century, the Romans hated the Jews and the Jews hated the Romans, pretty much. And also the Jews and the Gentiles, they didn't get along too well. And of course, there's always the antagonism between the Jews and the Samaritans. The Samaritans viewed the Jews as Elias, pretty much. And the Jews saw the Samaritans as half-breeds and were not worthy to worship at the temple. In our culture, the hostility continues. It seems that the hostility right now in this political season is more between the red and the blue than it is the Jews and Gentiles. And the mainstream media and podcasters and all kinds of sources of media, some of that information has crept into the church, which is unavoidable. And Christians, some Christians, are verbally showing hostility towards one another. And if you're not aware of this, then I'm sorry, I don't want to offend you, but I don't know where you've been hanging out. But seriously, this is a major concern. In fact, in March 3rd of this year, the Atlantic publication, Peter Wainer writes this, quote, "Democrats and Republicans both say that the other party's members are hypocritical, selfish, and closed-minded, and they're unwilling to socialize across party lines," end quote. Theologian and pastor Erwin Lutzer, when he was talking about this very topic in his one book that's called Christian Politics and the Cross, he pulls out what Nietzsche did during World War II, right before Hitler became in power. And he says this in a mocking fashion towards Christians. He says, "To make me believe in their," Christians, "redeemer, more redeemed would his disciples have to appear." In other words, Erwin Lutzer elaborates, the followers of Christ should look more like the Redeemer. While Nietzsche never had any moral ground whatsoever to stand and criticize in this fashion, remember, he's the one that was the philosopher of the God is dead philosophy, which again gave rise to Hitler, when Hitler propagated that there would be a Superman who would return to Germany with great force and make it rise up again. That came from Nietzsche's philosophy. Nietzsche does have a point, however. When Christians are fighting over politics, are we looking like our Redeemer? A few caveats, okay? So before you walk out on me and say, oh gosh, we're going to talk about politics. Actually, we're not. But even if we were, Romans 13, 1 Peter 2, the book of Daniel, Nehemiah, throughout Scripture, Luke chapter 8, did you know one of the financial supporters of our Lord Jesus was the wife of a Roman officer and office holder? Did you know that? Luke chapter 8 brings that up. So before we say politics are not written for the church, can we just put that myth to bed? In fact, if you look at the U.S. Constitution and everything written in it, most of that stuff was heralded from pulpits In early America, in the 13 colonies, most of it, and they, the founding fathers, took a lot of that and put it into the documents that we know today as the Constitution and the Bill of Rights. That was heralded. But we're not going to go there. But here are the caveats. Number one, we are not calling anyone in, or anyone to abandon being involved in politics. If you have a passion to be involved in politics, go for it. As I've already given an apology, the Bible supports that. So if you like being involved, like my brother does, it's interesting. Every time my brother calls me, she can verify this, I feel like I'm in a press conference in Washington. Okay, Paul, now the first item. Here's what we're going to talk about. Here's the second item. And here, oh, one final thing. And I go, I got to go. I got a patient. Say, well, no, one more thing. And he's going on, you know. And that's my brother. And I, you know, he was involved in politics. He loves it. He lives for this time. It is a crack cocaine high for him, if you will. And if he's watching, you know I love you. So in the book of Philippians, a culture very much like ours that pushed for liberties and personal freedoms, freedom, baby, right? This was Philippi. Philippi was exempt from a lot of things that Roman colonies had to do, like pay excise taxes and all kinds of, but they were free from a lot of that. And they loved their liberty and they bragged about it. The Apostle Paul's in jail, in the Roman jail at this time, when he writes the book of Philippians. Okay, so keep that in mind. He writes Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, and Colossians. You know how you remember that? General Electric Power Company. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, and Colossians. Those were all written during this imprisonment. And he has these emissaries who deliver them, of which one is called Epaphroditus. He's the pastor currently of this church in Philippi. And he comes with good news and bad news. The good news is the church in Philippi is financially supporting Paul because in those days in the first century, you had to pay for your room and board if you went to jail. Yeah, that sounds like a good company. Can we kind of push that one through? I think we can all get unity on that one. And so the church was supporting that. But there was also bad news. Epaphroditus says there's divisions in the camp. In fact, there were two people in the camp that were having such disagreements, they couldn't park their pride. And this contention was so bad, it was impacting negatively the furtherance of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So Paul takes up pen and he writes this beautiful four-chapter book that we know as Philippians. A lot of background, right? But it begs the question, like in Paul's day, how are we to respond to a politically divisive culture in which we now live? I mean, there are more questions than I have answers for when it comes to how to live in this fashion. One of the questions that you keep driving back to me, maybe we'll talk about this, is how do we discern truth in the midst of a maligning, misrepresenting media? I mean, if you don't think the media is lying to us, you really need to come to terms with that. There's a lot of misinformation out there. So how do you discern? That's one of the questions here. But today we're talking about how do we live in a politically divisive culture? How do we follow Christ to look more like him than the world? In other words, how do we follow Jesus in a politically polarized culture? This is a tall menu. It is a huge mountain that we are, don't leave me, don't sack out, stay with me. We're going to get to the mountain peak, but I need your help. I need you to be praying, and I need your assistance in listening, because this is a tall agenda that requires us to pray again. And that we do, Father, because your word is very clear on how we are to walk in any circumstance of our lives. And this one's no exception in the political world. So guide our thinking. Lord, may people hear what you want to hear, and anything else, remove it. This is not about what I say. It's about what your words are saying from your book, the Bible. Because that is truth. Jesus said, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. So we open up the truth right now, Lord. Let it change hearts and minds in Jesus' name. Amen. So let's think about this. How do we walk through? How do we follow Christ in this politically charged culture? I've got three things I'm going to share with you. We follow him by submitting to his motivations, by his prescription, submitting to his prescriptions, and also we follow him by submitting to his position. His motivations, his prescription, and his position. All these things, these three things, are what Paul outlines for unity back in this church in Philippi. Now remember, their culture's just like ours. These people were divisive just like you and I can be. They were opinionated, just as big and opinionated as the talking heads on CNN or Fox News or whatever channel you listen to. They were opinionated, just like we elect to be. So let's look at this. First of all, we want to follow Jesus by submitting to his motivations. My Bible's open to Philippians chapter 2, and Paul writes, therefore. Whenever we see therefore, what is it telling us in Scripture? Why is it therefore? Right? Paul is continuing a thought that he began up in chapter 1. Now remember, chapter breaks were not something on Paul's letter. When he wrote, these words and sentences were all together in what we call uncials, meaning capital letters. It wasn't until about 300 years after where these chapter divisions and verse breaks began to occur. So Paul's just continuing his thought in his letter. Don't let chapter 2, right in the middle of your Bible, confuse you. He's continuing the thought that he started in chapter 27, which says this, only conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or remain absent, I will hear about you, that you are standing firm in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. In other words, live out your life and look like Christ. So then he says, therefore, and here's the motivations. If there's any encouragement in Christ, meaning that Christ consoles us and he exhorts us to follow him. Sometimes he comes alongside of us and puts his arm around him and says, I love you, we're going to get through this. And other times he says, deny yourself, pick up your cross, and follow me. Sorry, that's a little bit loud, isn't it? There, that's probably a little better. I was hearing some feedback. So he says, if there's any encouragement in Christ, that's the first one. Notice how the Godhead's involved in our motivation. There's encouragement from Christ. If any consolation of love, most scholars believe that's the love that comes from the Father God. Consolation of love. You know, the great thing about God's consolation of love, the one who knows us best loves us the most. Can you let that sink in today? The one who knows us best loves us the most. So regardless of what someone else thinks about your political opinion, the Heavenly Father loves you most, even though he knows about your political opinion. And quite frankly, he doesn't really care. So that's the second thing. Here's the third thing. Any fellowship of the Spirit. The sharing of fellowship of the Spirit, which involves our union. All of these things develop unity within the church. The encouragement of Christ, The consolation of love from the Father, the Spirit's unity. Do you know that we all have the Spirit of God living within us? And that alone should be a factor of unity. Despite what the other person on the other side of the aisle believes, my relationship with you through Jesus Christ is more important than whether you have a donkey or an elephant in your garage. It doesn't really matter. I am union. I have unity with you because of Christ. It took me a long time to get that through my thick skull. Now, I may not agree with some of your positions. I may challenge you with questions about your position. So please don't be offended if you start challenging me and I come back and start pounding you with questions. Don't be offended. I probably won't do that because I respect you too much. But we do have this unity that surpasses politics. Fourthly, he says, if any affection and compassion, he's talking about the way that you treated me and helped me out in prison. Knowing all these factors, we have unity. These are the motivations. We have the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and our own love for one another. These are motivators for our unity. Don't neglect them. These are truths handed down by the Godhead for us to have unity. It's not that we hope this happens. It's true. They're true. So those are the motivators. But what about the prescriptions? It's one thing to talk about something a little bit vague. You know, those are kind of vague terms. All right? The exhortation from the encouragement from Christ, the consolation of love, fellowship of the Spirit, our compassion and love for one another. Those are all up here. Those are terms. And we can talk about them. We can study them. We go, yeah, that all sounds good. But what does that look like? And that's where Paul turns to prescriptions. The prescriptions for unity. We follow Christ through a polarized culture by submitting to his prescriptions. First of all, look at his prescriptions for unity. Verse 2, he says, make my joy complete. Paul was joyful that the church was involved with him and they were still welcoming his ministry by supporting him. And he was delighted to be part of their church family. And there was this mutual love for one another. So he had joy, but now he's saying, make my joy complete. Make it full. How? Well, he tells us. By being of the same mind. You know, if I come up against a disagreement with someone over politics or any other topic that is not thus saith the Lord, I need to seek the mind of Christ with that person. Especially if it's becoming heated. It is my job to pursue the mind of Christ and say, Lord, you know what? This is not going well. And I'm having this internal conversation with myself and the Lord, and I'm saying, God, I need your help to pursue your mind. Where is your mind in this? Do we stop the conversation? Do we press on? Do we change the subject? Or do we reflect and refocus and say, you know what, maybe we shouldn't talk about this. Our unity with Christ is far more important than whether or not you win this debate or I win this debate. Maybe we need to do that. We pursue the mind of Christ. Second of all, we maintain the same love. Isn't that interesting? Isn't it interesting how easy it is when you see someone who's got a bumper sticker that you agree with, and all of a sudden you feel an affection for them, right? And then you see them, you know what bumper sticker really drives me up the wall? Can I be candid with you? Is that one that says, can't we all get along? And it's got all those religious symbols on there. And I'm going, yeah, but one of those symbols wants to kill me. How do I get along with that person? Right? I mean, I'm always kind of joking in the back of my head when I'm driving down the road. But when I see someone with a bumper sticker I have affinity with, piece of cake. I can walk up to them after they park in the Walmart parking lot. Hey, how you doing? Start with. But if it's someone I disagree, no, Paul says, having the same love, loving the person, whether I agree with them or not, politically, Paul says we're called to do that. That's the prescription for unity. United in spirit, working together to build up the fellowship that we have, not tearing it down. Not acting like the two women that Paul has to address in chapter 4 who were more concerned about their agenda than parking their pride. And the fourth one is simply this. United in spirit, intent on one purpose. If nothing else, we are united on our one purpose, and that is to develop a passion for God and compassion for people through the life-changing message of Jesus Christ. That's our one purpose. And that we can agree upon. We can put aside our differences and say, that's our focus. That's our purpose, beloved. And that's what we're going to go for. We're making disciples of people who will make disciples. And that's what Paul says. That's the prescription for unity. Now, a clarification between unity and uniformity. Number one, unity is always inwardly motivated. It comes from a change of my heart. It comes from within the person, and then it demonstrates outwardly. It's an inward. Unity is something that happens inwardly and then manifests itself outwardly. Uniformity is a result of pressure from without. You know? Remember the old Hogan's Heroes? We will make you talk and you sit down, acton, right? We put the light over you and you went, Hogan, where is the tunnel, right? Remember that? That's uniformity. That, and if you don't do it, we'll give you 50 lashes with a wet noodle or whatever it was, you know, 30 days in the cooler. That was a proverbial punishment on Hogan's Heroes. That's uniformity. And sometimes corporations do this. I wish I had time to go into that. But all of a sudden, sometimes political parties, if you don't check all the boxes, you're out of here. That's uniformity. The beautiful thing in the body of Christ, when it comes to things that are not, thus saith the Lord, we don't demand you to check that box. Sure, we have a doctrinal statement and a code of fellowship. Yes, we do. And those things are all found right here. They're not things that are made up from some denomination or group of men. They're made by God. Uniformity is outward. Unity is inward and then comes out. So we had a prescription for unity. Let's look at what is the prescription for disunity. Notice what Paul says in verses 3 and 4. He says, now this is critical. Now we're getting down to the nitty gritty. We are really bringing the plane down and you can hear the tires screech. All right? Do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit. Selfishness, you know, part of the roots of this word, very interesting. Get this. Selfishness involves partisanship, strife, and factions. Paul tells us, we'll have none of that in the church. That is not what we're about. Second of all, do nothing from empty conceit. That means pursuing an agenda for your own personal glory. Whenever you see those two things, selfishness and empty conceit, I'll guarantee you, you will see a divided family, a divided relationship, a divided government, and a divided church. That's guaranteed. And Paul says, we'll have none of that. We need a prescription against that. What's the prescription? Well, he tells us, look at verse 4. Actually, the bottom of verse 3. Do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility, consider one another as more important than yourselves. Now, this doesn't mean you walk around with this fake humility going, oh, you're better than I am, and I'm just this poor guy, and I'm glad to be here. It's not what it's about. It's not a false humility. Notice what Paul says. Consider one more important than yourselves. How? Verse 4. Do not merely look out for your own personal interests, but also for the interests of others. How do you show honor and preference? You're concerned for the other person's needs as much as you're concerned for your own. We can do that. Can't we? We can do that. That's what Christ has called us to. This type of humility. This is the mindset who are not conceited, but have a right attitude towards others. I love what Romans 12:10 says. It's a beautiful summary of what Paul's talking about here. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Give preference to one another in honor. Verse 11, not lagging behind in diligence. Wow. In other words, remember the old Chip and Dale cartoon? Remember Walt Disney, Chip and Dale? Remember the two chipmunks, right? And you remember they're always fighting over what? No, you go in their little hole when someone was chasing them. They were diving into the hole. And they go, you go first. No, you go first. No, you. Well, we'll go together. Okay. And they go together, right? They were trying to outdo one another in honor. Wouldn't it be great if Heritage Bible Church, and this is true, but even more so, wouldn't it be great if people in Sagewood, Desert Willow, and Acacia knew Heritage Bible Church as the people who try to outdo one another in service? Do you think that would build community within the community? When they see us trying to outdo one another, and again, legitimately, authentically, we're not talking about a facade or fake. We're talking about how can we serve one another? Where I'm concerned not only for my own needs, but your needs. Would that be cool or what? Think about that. So that's the prescription. So we've seen the motivation. We've seen the prescription. Now let's look at how do we follow Christ in a polarized culture by submitting to his position. This is the end of what Whitney read. Thank you, Whitney, for reading from I-5 to 11. God's position, first of all, calls us to adopt Christ's attitude. Look at verse 5. Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus. In other words, keep on having this attitude. Don't just go, okay, I got it. And then on Monday morning at 10 o'clock, I don't need that attitude anymore. No, we need to keep on adopting that attitude. When I catch myself rolling into what the world wants me to do, I need to go, no, I need to come back. Lord, center me on your attitude of humility. I need to adopt that. Second of all, God's position calls me to duplicate his attitude. And we're just going to walk through these. We don't have time to delineate them. But watch with me in verses 6 through 8. He was already existed in the form of God. This is talking about Christ's humility and becoming a man from living in heaven and being God, eternally God. Think about that. Think about how God, Jesus Christ, humbled himself by coming from glory to taking on the flesh of a human being, man, with all the characteristics, with all the emotions, with all the aches and pains of getting up in the next morning when you were sleeping wrong on that rock in the middle of a desert. By the way, he didn't have much of many possessions, did he? He didn't have a home. I don't know if he had a blanket. He didn't have a bank account, 401k. None of that. He humbled himself. Paul says he existed in the form of God, meaning he had the very essence of God, and he took on, he did not consider equality with God something to grasp. In other words, when he was on earth, he didn't go, you know what? I don't want to do this. I think I'm going to connect with my divine powers that I have, my omnipotence, my omniscience. I'm going to connect with that. I'm going to pull it off the shelf, and I'm going to use it for this, my agenda. He did not do that. It's very easy for us to use our position and power to shut up the opposition, isn't it? We are good at that. When I say we, I'm talking about our culture, okay? Whether you are, that's between you and God. And while the other person is talking about their points, guess what the culture's thinking about? Guess what you might be thinking, or I might be thinking? I might be thinking, I'm not listening to this guy because I'm thinking about the next thing I'm going to hit him with. Paul says, don't do that. Take on the attitude. Emulate what Christ did. Humble yourselves. In the verse 7, but he emptied himself by taking the form of a bondservant and being born in the likeness of men. So he came from glory. He set aside his divine. He had them. He just chose not to use them. He submitted them to the Father. And he took on the form of a bondservant, meaning that he served others. He served not what their perceived need was, but their real need was. What was our real need? It was reconciliation with God the Father. That's the real need. And that's what we need to be focused on with the people that we disagree with. What is the real need, Lord? Again, the mind of Christ. Lord, what's the real need here? Verse 8. And being found in appearance as man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, death on the cross. God calls us not only to serve others, but to serve others sacrificially. It costs me something. It costs my time. It costs my talent. It costs my treasure. Something God is going to ask our church to sacrifice to serve other people that we disagree with. It is as true as true north. So we humble ourselves. We serve others. We sacrifice for others. Why do we do all this? We'll look at verses 9 through 11. Because Christ did all this, for this reason, God highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name. So at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow of those who are in heaven and on earth and under the earth. And that every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Why do we do all this? Why are we called to submit to his motivations, his prescriptions, and his position so that we glorify God the Father, just like Jesus did. Bringing down the thunder today. Old-fashioned country preacher going crazy. Had a friend of mine anyway, just a country preacher, you know. Anyway, the point is that all we do all this, we adopt Christ's attitude, and we duplicate Christ's attitude for one reason, to glorify the Father. Not to glorify the elephant in the room, or the donkey, or some other symbol. It gets back to glorifying one person, God the Father, through Jesus Christ. Now, I had a conclusion, but I wrote another one this morning. See if this makes sense. This election, what would it look like if we decided to take God's word seriously? And personally, I'm calling each and every one of us to not walk out these doors and go, well, that was nice, that was meant for so-and-so sitting next to my right or my left. Lord, I pray for them to get their act straight. What would our community look like if we asked the Lord to take his motivations for unity seriously? If we took personal responsibility for unity, how might that change not only this church looks, but how the community at large looks? When there are conflicts, how might God's prescriptions for unity and disunity calm egos and create space for humility and service towards others? How might these changes impact how we look at those watching us in our community? Finally, will you join me in submitting to God's position as we adopt the attitude of Christ, humility? Will we park our pride in our hearts and allow Christ's attitude to permeate our thoughts during the day so that we have the mind of Christ? And as our Lord Jesus Christ permeates our thoughts, let's celebrate how he uses us to serve and sacrifice for others, and ultimately glorifying our God and Father. In other words, will you and I walk with Jesus in this politically polarized culture simply by submitting to his word? That's the question. That's the challenge. I told you it was a tough hill, but we got to the peak. We got to the mountaintop. We can see clearly now. God is calling us to submit to his word by submitting to his motivations, his prescription, and ultimately his position as Lord. Father, you are our Lord. Jesus Christ is our King. And you've declared clearly how we are to walk and follow you in this polarized culture. It's challenging, Lord. This is extremely challenging. It rubs us the other way as Americans. This is not about giving up on America or our values. It's a heart check of where we're at with you. Give us humility, Lord, to submit to your word. For Christ's glory and honor, in Jesus' name, amen. We are going to sing the benediction song, and I'm going to invite Warner to come up. He's going to lead us, and because my voice is just sounds like a coyote, and so Warner, we're going to sing it through twice. Kelly's going to play it, and Warner's going to help lead us today. Warner, thank you.
Could I say just a word about the word benediction? When the pastor gives the benediction at the end of the service, it's asking God to bless us all. But this benediction song is one which I see as being blessing each other, which is uniting the culture. Right? So our heritage singers have decided we would like to have the congregation sing this song to each other as a benediction to each other, because when we bless each other, we're asking God to bless each other. So it's a benediction from each one to each other. So we're going to sing it through twice. Joan asked me to memorize it, and I haven't done that quite yet. So I'm going to have to turn my back to you a little bit. But we'll get through it. So sing it with us. If you want to sing both times with me through it, fine. We'll do that, but let's sing it together with a real thought of blessing the person on your right and on your left and behind and in front. Here we go. Thank you. Even the coyotes.
No.
Thank you, Warrior. God bless you, brother. Thank you. Hey, Warner, doing a good job. I asked him on the spot to do that for us today. So, Warner, thank you so much. God bless you. Have a great week. And we will see you during the week. If not, Lord willing, we'll see you next Sunday. God bless you all.